Well, I hope that was a positive experience for you.
Amen.
We're going to pray. As we pray, I want you to realize what a privilege it is to be in the house of God this morning.
Amen.
God has saved us, offered us eternal life. He's blessed like nobody's business. He heals us, pours out his mercy on us. He draws us to him. We go through stuff that draws us to him. And what a privilege it is to come once a week to worship him. We're going to look in a minute at how the Israelites had to worship him in a whole lot harder way than we do today. So I want you to pray. I want you to pray with me. Thank the Lord for the privilege of being in his presence this morning. As we pray, remember Holly and Greg. Greg twisted his knee after surgery and he had been taken to the hospital. His wife's really upset, so we'll pray for Holly and Greg as well. But let's pray the Lord for each of us. Father Almighty, we worship you. We come before the throne of God. Humility, praise, Father, with prayer concerns, understanding, Lord, what you did on the cross for us, knowing the cost of our freedom, our salvation. Thank you, God, for dying for us, for our sins. Thank you for allowing us to ask forgiveness for those sins and asking to be a child of God. You grant that for us. Bible says we're heirs of Christ. We inherit heaven for eternity. We inherit the things of Christ forever. Thank you, God, for the tremendous mercy that you pour out on your people. Lord, we don't always like what's going on around us, and sometimes very hurtful things that happen. But we know, Father, that the Bible tells us that all these things will just draw us closer to you and make us depend on you more. I pray, Lord, for your church. I pray that the church will return back to you. Father, that we will worship you. Really mean worship. Really mean to meet you face to face. Really mean to presence of God. Father, help us to not take worship for granted. Lord, I do pray for Holly and Greg. I pray, Lord, that you would touch Greg's knee. Lord, that you would call Holly down and give her encouragement and love. Pray for this service, Lord, that we would glorify the name of the Lord Jesus. Today we tell you how much we love you. We love you with all our heart, mind, and soul. Father, as we open up Psalm 121, I pray for your wisdom, your thoughts. Pray, Lord, that whatever comes out of my mouth will be words of God. May we pierce our hearts, Father, that we would leave here different. Thank you for each person here this morning. I ask your blessings. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to look at Psalm 121 today. We looked at Psalm 120 last week. These are called Psalms of Ascent. The word ascent means to go up the hill, to go up the mountain. It's meant to worship God. The Israelites were called by God to worship him at least three times a year, to go up to Jerusalem, the mountain surrounding Jerusalem, the holy hill of Jerusalem. Says, and worship God. As they worship God, they poured out their hearts to him in praise and calling out for help. They knew that they would soon be in the presence of God as they get on top of the holy hill to worship him. But last week I said they worshiped three different times, and I want to share with you from where I got that from. So if you would, run back to Deuteronomy chapter 16. feast, three feasts that God commanded people to go worship Him, to go up the hill, to ascend to the holy hill and worship God. So Deuteronomy chapter 16, verses 16 and 17. The Bible says, three times a year all your males shall appear before the Lord your God in the place which He chooses, at the feast of the unleavened bread, at the feast of weeks, and at the feast of tabernacles. They shall not appear before the Lord empty-handed. Every man shall give as he is able, according to the blessing of the Lord your God, which He has given you. So the feast of unleavened bread is the feast of Passover. This is where the Israelites were to paint the door frame with blood, and God would pass over and not kill the firstborn. The Feast of Weeks is what we call the Feast of Pentecost. And remember in Acts chapter 2, where over 3,000 people came to know the Lord in just a second, and that was the celebration of Pentecost. And if you think about the worship of the Feast of Pentecost, it was the first harvest, it was the first picking. That's kind of like the picture of the church. Back then, 3,000 people came to know the Lord at the first church. And now look at what's happening now. We get to the end of the year, the Feast of Tabernacles or the Feast of Booths. And this is the great harvest. This is the final harvest for the year. So it's just a picture of the church. We're to worship the Lord God. And Psalm 121, let's read it together. This is their worship. This is their song of ascents. This is what they're singing to God. The Bible says, I will lift up my eyes to the hills from whence comes my help. My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, He keeps Israel. He shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out, your coming in, from this time forth and forevermore. So the God's people are called by God to go up the mountainside to worship God these feast times. And they're told to sing these songs to the Lord. We sing God's word back to Him. That's what they did over and over. They sing Psalm 122, 134. And it was just a form of worship, but it was kind of more than that. Let me remind you that these people, God's people, were just like you and I. They were just normal people. They had the same problems that you and I have. They had sickness. They had financial difficulties. They had marriage difficulties. Some were wealthy, some were poor. Some of them didn't know whether to worship God or worship idols. They were just confused, some of them. There were really no difference between them and us. Yet God commanded them to drop what they were doing, these feasts, and to go up and worship God, and they did. They would get out there carrying those burdens on their shoulders like you and I do. For instance, maybe one of them, their spouse had died, and that very week, but they still got on that path to go worship God. So can you imagine them going through the stuff of life and kind of droopy shoulder, but knowing they're going to get in the presence of God. So they leave here, and by the time they get over there, they've sung all these songs together, and their hearts are just overwhelmed with joy. That's kind of a picture of what God expects from us. We go through stuff, don't we? Pretty rough stuff here lately. We're scared sometimes. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. As we face Sunday school next week, I don't know what we're going to face. It's just a scary time. But God knows. We worship God. And we trust God. And we depend on God. We put, if you will, all our eggs in God's basket. We allow God to take care of us, and as we do, we worship Him. And last week we saw where God was in their past, He was in their present. says, as I get out of this path going to worship God, I will lift up my eyes to the hills from whence comes my help. As you read that, if you're in the New King James Version, there's a question mark at the end. If you're King James, there's a period at the end. So one's asking a question and one's making a statement, but when you put it all together, it's actually the same thought behind it. They knew where their help came from. We'll get to that in verse 2. The question becomes, do we know where our help comes from?
Amen.
We were talking this morning about sin and how in the world can somebody commit an atrocious sin to be saved? Well, those kinds of people don't necessarily know where their help comes from. They could be saved and still commit sin. Anybody in here perfect, by the way? No, so we all sin, don't we? In God's eye, sin's just as bad. My sin is your sin. So, do we know where our help comes from in dealing with sin? Do we know where our help comes in dealing with life? If you've ever been over in one of the far eastern countries, you look up on the hillside, there's all sorts of altars made out of wooden thing, carved images. I'm talking about hundreds. I've seen them, hundreds and even thousands of them. The mountainside's big enough. And people go each week and worship their God at these little altars on the hillside. So during the time Psalm 121 was written, Judah was worshiping other gods. They were worshiping Baal. They were committing idolatry. So God gives instruction in Psalm 21, verse 1. Look to the hills. Where does your help come from? And like today, some of them could say, I know where my help comes from. Can you say that today? You know absolutely where your help comes from. I hope you can. But there may be some sitting in here saying, I've got some doubts about this. I'm not sure where my help comes from. Not quite got there yet. That's okay. Come about the time we get there, you come to know where your help comes from. In fact, as they worship these Judah, I mean God's own people, were worshiping God, they were still going and singing these songs, and they went up to the hill worshiping God. By the time they got there, God would remind them that they belonged to Him. They're God's people. We worship Him through songs. We worship Him even in our sin. Look at verse 2. My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He addresses God as Lord. God is Lord of his life. Those that look up at the hills, look up at God, we focus on the throne of God, we focus on our hearts, on God's heart. He's our Lord. As He's our Lord, and you know that, and you go before the throne, and this is what the psalmist was saying. You're my Lord. You created this earth. You created the heavens. He's given God the glory for who He is. So as they get out of this path going up to worship God, they're singing this, and some of them don't know who God is. They're just copying people. They're just doing things out because that's what they were told to do. And others, they knew who their Lord was. So here's my question to you guys. As you look up, do you know where your help comes from?
Amen. Amen.
And do you know God as your Lord?
Amen.
We're going to worship God. We're going to worship our Lord. We're going to be going up this hill together. We do that every Sunday. We worship together. We come here because we want to feel the presence of the Lord. You don't come here to hear Jerry talk. You come here to feel the presence of God. I pray and try my best to get what God is saying and share that with you, but you don't come here, you guys know me, you don't come here for my knowledge. You come here for God.
Amen.
So he said, your Lord, and the reason I'm asking him to hang around here for so long, because of the stuff we're facing right now. And be honest, how many of us have asked, why in the world is this happening? Why is this COVID around here? Why can't I pay my electric bill? Why do I have health issues? Have you ever asked something like that to God? I don't see a single head, but I know you have. Yeah, there you go. Finally, somebody. You don't have to come up to the altar. Everybody else does at the invitation. God is our creator. He created this heaven and he created this earth. And these people are going to worship that God, that Lord, the creator of heaven and earth. And we, every Sunday, we worship the creator of heaven and earth. And let me tell you, my Lord, your Lord, he could do something about COVID-19 if he wanted to. Do you agree with that?
Yeah.
He could do something with a heart attack. If he wanted to, he could get rid of heart disease and cancers and things like that.
Amen.
He could get rid of the junk of life. Maybe we're not worshiping God the way we ought to.
All right.
Just a thought. As I went through this, my heart was kind of breaking. I wanted to worship God, but I got to get right with God before I can worship God. So did these people. They start their pilgrimage and they're looking up at their pilgrimage, and then they're looking up at the hills, and some of them know where they're headed. Some don't. We're the same way. And there's a church in Revelation. It's called the Lukewarm Church. I believe the churches are lukewarm. What's the Bible say about those lukewarm churches in the Bible? Well, they make God sick. It throws up on the Bible. So why do we have COVID-19? And why do we have things in this life that's happening now? Maybe it's God getting our attention because we're not worshiping him the way we ought to. Maybe we're not giving him the credit for being creator of this world, heaven and earth. He's got the answers. Again, preachers meditating and praying through this, and then I'm thinking with my human brain, the way we worship now. We worship, most of us, Sunday morning only. We've made worship very easy. If I preach, well, you guys don't mind so much if I preach over 12 o'clock. A lot of preachers get in trouble for preaching over 12 to, if they go 5 after 12, people let them know about that. We've made our worship times way too easy for the Lord. He's commanded us to do so many things that we've cut them out of our worship times. Back in my first church, when I first got out of seminary, I went to a little family country church. Two families in that church. One of them was a deacon, one of the guys in one of the families was a deacon. And every single Sunday, at 5 till 12, this is what he would do. He'd be sitting in his pew right in front of me. You know what I'm talking about. Well, I was green. Jimmy did that to me every single week. Finally, I got tired of it. I preached for 2.5 hours that morning. Not a single one of them left. They got on the phone and that phone was buzzing. And the next week, we had twice as many people there as we did the week before. We have made worship way too easy. And God had called those people to make pilgrimages at least 3 times a year. Give up their livelihood, to give up their things, to leave them behind, to get out of those paths. And sometimes it would take weeks to get up to the mountainside to worship God. Now, how many of you, if I put out a phone tree this week and say, meet me at church at 7 o'clock Saturday morning, we're going to spend some time, we're going to walk to Nashville, to First Baptist Nashville, we're going to worship Sunday mornings together. How many of you would meet me and say, I'm walking to Nashville with the preacher?
Amen, brother.
God will not allow our feet to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall not slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade, your right hand. They would sing this back to God. He doesn't allow your feet to be moved. I mean, he takes care of your feet. As you're walking these treacherous little paths up there, he's taking care of every single need. And some of those things, you had to walk over the big boulders to get to them. And if you've ever tried to climb a boulder, sometimes they're kind of slippery. And some of you are young, but the older you get, those big boulders cause you hardships.
All right.
Again, you know what I'm talking about, Bobby. Some of us don't have all our needs. They don't want to go over boulders. Yet these people did, and they sang to God, God, you guard our feet, you take care of that for us. They trusted God, they depended on God. And then verse 4, or the last part of verse 3, he who keeps you will not slumber. God's not taking a nap during this time. Verse 5, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. Let me tell you, your God never sleeps.
Amen.
You can call on God right now, or you can call on God 12 o'clock tonight, and he'll be awake. Those people in China can pray because it's dark over there now. They can pray and be heard just like we can pray right now and be heard. God never sleeps. And it seems like some of the health issues, like heart attacks and things like that, happen when we're least expecting it. Sometimes at nighttime, God's still awake. God's watching over. And they're singing this back to him as they travel up to worship. And look at verse 5. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. Oh, man. This word keeper is the same as he's our guardian. He's our protector. He's our provider. It's his responsibility to keep the people that he's a keeper of. Did that come out right? What a blessing it is to know that God is my keeper. Your keeper. Some of us are pretty wild at times. We get way outside of God's will sometimes, preacher included. Yet God is my keeper. God is your keeper. And as we go to worship God, we're singing these things, and pretty soon these things will cause you to confess your sins to him, and it brings you back into his will. So he's kind of got his arms around you. You're not going to get out of his arms when he's your keeper. Thank you, God, for being our keeper.
Amen.
Look at verse 6. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. Day and night. Day and night. He's our keeper. Day and night. He's our protector. He's our provider. So here's my question. You believe in your heart that God is your keeper.
Amen.
He's your protector.
Amen.
I have the privilege of praying for you guys. You'll call me and ask me to pray for you. And my prayer list is not that long. And I pray for you when you ask me to. And I ask God to take care of you and to let you know that he's got his arms wrapped around you. And what a joy it is to know that when we're down and depressed and getting worse, that God is going to lift us up. That's what I pray for us. He's our keeper. And God is responsible for his people. They're singing this song as they worship God as their keeper and their protector and their guardian. And then verse 8. Pretty amazing. Verses 7 and 8 both. All three, I mean, both these verses have three words, the word preserved three times. So listen as I read 7 and 8, and listen for the word preserved. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. Did you hear that? All evil he preserves us. He shall preserve your soul. He shall preserve your going out and your coming in. From this time forth, from this very moment, even forevermore. Even forevermore sounds to me like eternity, forever, eternal. I mean, it's going to be forever and ever and ever. So three times he says, I preserve you. I preserve you from all evil. And we were talking about sin, but if we give our heart to the Lord, and He knows that we're going to continue in sin, God is still keeping us. He's still preserving us. He's got His ways of getting our attention when we're sinful. The Bible says He preserves our soul. Remember when Jesus says in John chapter 10, I am the good shepherd, and I am the Father of one, and Satan can't steal you, you can't lose you. He is the keeper of our souls. And there's absolutely nothing we can do to get outside of His keeping of our souls. He preserves our soul. And then verse 8, the Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in. The whole day, the whole night, wherever you're at, the Lord is preserving us. This is a fantastic song to sing to the Lord. You don't have to sing it with music, some of you could. But you can repeat that just back to the Lord in prayer as you worship Him. God, you are my keeper, you are my preserver, you're my protector, you're my guardian, you are the provider of all things for me. As you sing it back to God, you're reminding Him, more than that, you're reminding yourself of who He is. It wasn't possible to get down, really down when you start focusing on God. And that's what this whole journey is about. They leave their belongings, they leave wherever they're going. Farming their businesses. They go up to the mountain, the mount surrounding Jerusalem, and they worship God. So what's the point of all this? If God is your keeper, and God is your preserver, God created the earth as well as the heavens. He created everything on the earth, everything in the heavens. Everything is created by Him. He's your keeper. He's in control of all this stuff we call life. When you take the old and we read it, so that doesn't apply, but when you read the New Testament with the Old Testament, realize it does apply. And there's one verse in the Bible that kind of says, like a front of you. You put the whole and the new in, and you shake it out, and you look at John 14:6. I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So He's our keeper. And yes, sometimes we're sinful, but He's preserving us. As creator and guardian, He's in control of all things, including our eternity and where we're going to spend eternity. He's the way, the only way, the only truth, the only life. And you're not going to get to heaven with the Father except through Jesus. And that life, by the way, is life more abundant forever, for eternity. So it's pretty important to know. And yes, the Old Testament is still important. It ties in with the New Testament. You can't understand one without the other. So God, the creator of all things, both heaven and earth, and He's the only way to life, period. So we worship Him. We repeat back to the Lord, Lord, you're my Lord, you're my keeper, you're my provider, I depend on you for everything. And the list just goes on and on and on. We repeat that back to God. We sing it to God. We bless God by doing this. Don't you know, by the time we get to the mountain, our heart is overjoyed with worshiping God and how that pleases God. I read a devotion. I want to close with this thought. God went to such lengths as to control the events of the world and to sacrifice His one and only Son. Would it make any sense at all for Him to abandon you between the already when you're saved and the not yet of your final glorification, the final entry into heaven? Would it make make any sense for him to turn his back on me now? Would it make any sense for him to ignore you in the hour of need? Would you expend a great amount of personal effort and sacrifice to secure something of value and then not work to keep it? That's the same with God. He expended his life. And once he did that, he's not going to give up that work and that sacrifice and lose us, to give up on us. The fact that you are precious in God's sight is clear because he purchased you at a great price. No higher price could be paid than the death of the Messiah. But that's exactly the price that God paid to redeem you and me. Since he paid such a price, we can rest assured he will expend his divine power and grace to protect us, mature us, provide for us, and keep us until we are with him in a place without danger, disease, and all that other stuff that we face today. God is not going to give up on us.
Amen.
God is not going to forget about us. He does require us to look to him and worship him. The only way that we can worship the one true living God is to give him our heart. Some of us, I hope that all of us have Jesus in our life today. But if you don't, the Bible makes it so easy to call on the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. Invite Jesus into your heart and confess our sins. And he comes into our heart and changes us. We call it, the Bible calls it, a new birth. He creates a new heart in you, a new creation. If you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, there's nothing to be embarrassed about, but it's something we need to take care of. And I would love to pray with you after church, but we'll have an invitation. Our invitation is if you need to make a decision for Jesus, or if you just want to talk to him, this is the time to do it. I'm going to be up front. I would love to pray with you if you have a problem. If you need something prayed about, you can pray in your pew. You can come down here to the altar and pray. Please don't leave without having Jesus in your life. Maybe our worship has gotten a little lax. This would be a good time to say, Lord, forgive me for that kind of worship. Maybe we've lost our focus in life. It would be a pretty good time to say, Lord, draw me back to you. We're going to stand up. We're going to let God have his way. You figure out what God's saying. If you need to come forward, come on forward. Our Father Almighty, this is your time. I pray that you speak to our hearts. Lord, if there's anything that's bothering us or convicting us, I pray, Lord, nobody will.